May I welcome you to this carol service for the benefice of Christchurch Stone and Oulton with Moddershall. I'm very grateful for many people who've come in and recorded. It's been really difficult to try and put together a carol service, but we want to do it. We want to celebrate Christmas. I want to also give thanks for people in the community. There have been so many kindnesses shown, and it's been a great spirit of the community to pull together this really difficult time during the last year and with an unknown future. So thank you for all of that. It's been great inspiration. And I hope that Christmas will just fuel that as we see a different way of living because of knowing God personally. I'm going to use something of a formal introduction, which acts as a prayer as well as we come to this service. At Christmas time, we delight again to hear the story of the journey to Bethlehem, the song of the angels, the surprise of the shepherds, and their joy as they found Jesus in the manger. And because he was born to poverty, we remember at this season all who are hungry or cold. And because he became a refugee, we remember the stranger and the homeless among us. And because he felt the pain of life and death, we remember those who are ill or anxious or bereaved. And because we know he came for our salvation, let us in heart and mind go once again to Bethlehem to hear the message of the angels and worship afresh the Son of God. Let's now start with our carol service readings and songs.
The first lesson is from the book of Genesis, chapter 3. The fall of man. Now the serpent was more crafty than any of the wild animals the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, "Did God really say, 'You must not eat from any tree in the garden?'" The woman said to the serpent, "We may eat fruit from the trees in the garden, but God did say, 'You must not eat fruit from the tree that is in the middle of the garden, and you must not touch it, or you will die.'" "You will not surely die," the serpent said to the woman, "for God knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil." When the woman saw that the fruit of the tree was good for food, and pleasing to the eye, and also desirable for gaining wisdom, she took some and ate it. She also gave some to her husband, who was with her, and he ate it. Then the eyes of both of them were opened, and they realized that they were naked. So they sewed fig leaves together and made coverings for themselves. Then the man and his wife heard the sound of the Lord God as he was walking in the garden in the cool of the day, and they hid from the Lord God among the trees of the garden. But the Lord God called to the man, "Where are you?" He answered, "I heard you in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, so I hid." And he said, "Who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree from which I commanded you not to eat?" The man said, "The woman you put here with me, she gave me some fruit from the tree and I ate it." Then the Lord God said to the woman, "What is it you have done?" The woman said, "The serpent deceived me, and I ate." So the Lord God said to the serpent, "Because you have done this, cursed are you above all the livestock and all the wild animals. You will crawl on your belly, and you will eat dust all the days of your life, and I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and hers. He will crush your head, and you will strike his heel. Thanks be to God.
The second lesson is from Genesis chapter 22, the plan of redemption. Sometime later, God tested Abraham. He said to him, "Abraham?" "Here I am," he replied. Then God said, "Take your son, your only son Isaac, whom you love, and go to the region of Moriah. Sacrifice him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains I'll tell you about." Early the next morning, Abraham got up and saddled his donkey. He took with him two of his servants and his son Isaac. When he had cut enough wood for the burnt offering, he set out for the place God had told him about. On the third day, Abraham looked up and saw the place in the distance. He said to his servants, "Stay here with the donkey while I and the boy go over there. We will worship and then we will come back to you." Abraham took the wood for the burnt offering and placed it on his son Isaac, and he himself carried the fire and the knife. As the two of them went on together, Isaac spoke up and said to his father Abraham, "Father?" "Yes, my son," Abraham replied. "The fire and the wood are here," said Isaac, "but where is the lamb for the burnt offering?" Abraham answered, "God himself will provide the lamb for the burnt offering, my son." And the two of them went on together. When they reached the place God had told him about, Abraham built an altar there and arranged the wood on it. He bound his son Isaac and laid him on the altar on top of the wood. Then he reached out his hand and took the knife to slay his son. But the angel of the Lord called out to him from heaven, "Abraham, Abraham!" "Here I am," he replied. "Do not lay a hand on the boy," he said. "Do not do anything to him. Now I know that you fear God, because you have not withheld from me your son, your only son." Abraham looked up, and there in the thicket he saw a ram caught by its horns. He went over and took the ram and sacrificed it as a burnt offering instead of his son. So Abraham called that place, "The Lord will provide." and to this day it is said, on the mountain of the Lord it will be provided. The angel of the Lord called to Abraham from heaven a second time and said, I swear by myself, declares the Lord, that because you have done this and have not withheld your son, your only son, I will surely bless you and make your descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky and as the sand on the seashore. Your descendants will take possession of the cities of their enemies, and through your offspring all nations on earth will be blessed, because you have obeyed me. Thanks be to God.
Lesson is from chapter 9 of Isaiah. The prophet speaks of the Son and the Saviour. Nevertheless, there will be no more gloom for those who were in distress. In the past, he humbled the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, but in the future, he will honour Galilee of the Gentiles by the way of the sea along the Jordan. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of the shadow of death, a light has dawned. You have enlarged the nation and increased their joy. They rejoice before you as people rejoice at the harvest, as men rejoice when dividing the plunder. For as in the day of Midian's defeat, you have shattered the yoke that burdens them, the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor. Every warrior's boot used in battle and every garment rolled in blood will be destined for burning, will be fuel for the fire. For unto us a son is born, a child is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this. Thanks be to God.
Our fourth lesson is from the book of the prophet Micah, chapter 5, the promised ruler from Bethlehem. Marshal your troops, O city of troops, for a siege is laid against us. They will strike Israel's ruler on the cheek with a rod. But you, Bethlehem Ephrathah, though you are small among the clans of Judah, out of you will come for me one who will be ruler over Israel, whose origins are from of old, from ancient times. Therefore, Israel will be abandoned until the time when she who is in labour gives birth, and the rest of his brothers return to join the Israelites. He will stand and shepherd his flock in the strength of the Lord, in the majesty of the name of the Lord his God, and they will live securely, for then his greatness will reach to the ends of the earth, and he will be their peace. Thanks be to God.
Fifth lesson is from Luke chapter 1. The angel Gabriel brings good news to Mary. In the sixth month, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. The virgin's name was Mary. The angel went to her and said, "Greetings, you who are highly favoured. The Lord is with you." Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favour with God. You will be with child and give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever. His kingdom will never end." "How will this be?" Mary asked the angel, "since I am a virgin." The angel answered, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. Even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age, and she who was said to be barren is in her sixth month, for nothing is impossible with God." "I am the Lord's servant," Mary answered. "May it be to me as you have said." Then the angel left her. Thanks be to God.
The seventh lesson is taken from the book of Matthew, chapter 1, Isaiah's promise fulfilled in Jesus Christ. This is how the birth of Jesus Christ came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph, but before they came together, she was found to be with child through the Holy Spirit. Because Joseph, her husband, was a righteous man and did not want to expose her to public disgrace, he had in mind to divorce her quietly. But after he had considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins." All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophets. The virgin will be with child and will give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which means God with us. When Joseph woke up, he did what the angel of the Lord had commanded him and took Mary home as his wife. But he had no union with her until she gave birth to a son, and he gave him the name Jesus. Thanks be to God.
Soon deliver you.
The sixth lesson is taken from the Gospel according to St. Luke, chapter 2. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria, and everyone went to his own town to register. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn. And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. Today, in the town of David, a Saviour has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger." Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to men on whom his favor rests." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby, who was lying in the manger. When they'd seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned,
glorifying and praising God for all the things they'd seen and heard, which were just as they had been told. Thanks be to God.
Christmas is not just about a baby sleeping on some hay. The Redeemer's birth is a delightful piece of news for a dark and weary world. In the ancient world, the Roman Empire had spread so much, it was occupying many countries, they imposed their own laws, they raised taxes, they treated non-Romans as second-class citizens, and it threatened many livelihoods. And then there was that order to return home for the census. What a hassle it was to go back to your place of birth. Well, while some shepherds were watching their flocks at night to guard them against predators or thieves, an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. Fear is triggered, isn't it, by the threat of harm, whether that's real or just in our minds. And that makes us prepare for fight or flight. Well, the shepherds were certainly afraid of the unknown, the radiance of God's glory, a sense of his majestic presence. What would happen next? Was this their end? Well, they're told, do not be afraid. What great words those are for us at this time of great uncertainty, when many of us are fearing for our very lives. And actually, the same words were spoken by an angel to comfort Zechariah, the father of John the Baptist. When an angel spoke to him, we're told he was gripped with fear, but told not to be afraid because God had heard his prayer. His prayer was for his wife, who is now very, very old, to have had a child. He'd given up almost all hope, but now she was to have John the Baptist. And then an angel greeted Mary, and she was troubled and she didn't know what to make of it. But the angel said, do not be afraid. Mary, you've found favour with God. God had graciously chosen an ordinary sinner for an extraordinary purpose. Well, why should these shepherds not fear? Why should the others not fear? Well, the angel explains here in verse 10, I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. In other words, the angel had brought glad tidings of great joy and comfort. It wasn't just for the nobility. It wasn't just for the religious leaders. We're told it was for all the people, like the shepherds, these people who are quite ordinary at work. Well, I want to point out three things from this, just a couple of verses. Firstly, Jesus is the saviour of humanity. Jesus was born in the birthplace of King David. We're told today, verse 11, in the town of David, a saviour has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord. A saviour rescues from the threat of evil and the danger of harm. And because we are so caught up in our sins, we can't reach out to him, so he has come and reached out to us. Jesus came on a rescue mission, and it would involve giving up his own life for you and me. Later in the New Testament, the Apostle Paul writes, he who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also with him graciously give us all things? God has shown great kindness and generosity in sending a saviour. We're told he is the Christ, the Anointed One, another name is the Messiah, whom the people of Israel had been promised would come. He is the Lord, he's the most powerful person ever to be born and walk on earth. Well, in our difficulties, we can turn to this Jesus, who is stronger than all. His resurrection showed that he is even stronger than the power of death, the very thing that we says the last enemy we fear it the most. It terrorizes our lives, but the Saviour, he is able to reach out and help us. He's the Saviour of humanity. He saves us from sin and judgment and hell. Secondly, we see the sign of humility. Now, the shepherds are given some pretty crucial information as to where to find this child. This will be a sign to you. You'll find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger. Well, we know all babies need wrapping up to keep them warm, but lying in a manger, that's a feeding trough. Well, parents may remember strange things that they've done when they had young children. Perhaps when you went and bought your first cot and pram, you spent hours researching it, you spent far too much money, and you got the thing home. And then when you wanted to go away on holiday, you realised you needed to have something rather small, and maybe you improvised. Well, that's what goes on here, isn't it? The manger was a makeshift cot. And yet it confirmed that the baby was the saviour. The one who held the highest rank in the universe actually is the one who is humble. He is lowly. C.S. Lewis, the one who wrote the Narnia stories, was also quite a theologian in his day. He wrote this: "The essential vice, the utmost evil, is pride. Unchastity, anger, greed, drunkenness, and all that are mere flea bites in comparison. Pride is the complete anti-God state of mind. It is pride which has been the chief cause of misery in every nation and every family since the world began." Well, he wrote that in his book, Mere Christianity. Well, what a contrast with Jesus' life. He came in humility, and through his life and death, he provides the knockout blow to our biggest challenge. At the same time, he meets our deepest need. Jesus said, "Come to me, all who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." Well, when we come humbly and confess that we've been living as rebels, when we come to be forgiven, we'll be given rest for our souls. And rest is the result of having been reconciled to God. We were enemies, but now we've become friends through the Lord Jesus Christ. And it's the start of being a lifelong learner. We're yoked with Jesus as his disciples. It is the Christmas present worth having, and it's open to all of us. Well, lastly, and very briefly, we see the song of heaven in verse 13 and 14. "In the night sky, suddenly a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God, saying, 'Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to men on whom his favour rests.'" Well, the angels sang God's glory as they gave praise for his plan of redemption. The mystery of salvation had been revealed at last. So this is how God would provide redemption. This is how he'd come amongst us. This is how he would open up the new wave of coming to him and knowing him. Well, God is slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. And so they sang, "Glory to God in the highest. He alone is worthy of praise." I hope that that wells up in your life too. The message had a huge impact on the shepherds' lives. They shot off to see Jesus. It was the first Christmas rush. It was just as the angel said, the Saviour was lying there in a manger. They returned home praising God for the massive privilege of seeing him. But also the angel's message had an impact on the lives of others, because they started telling other people about what they heard and what they now knew as true. I wonder where that message spills out from our lives to others. Well, we too can join in the song of heaven when we receive the good news of being Jesus being our Saviour and Lord. When we understand that despite our background, our disappointments, our failures, even our successes and our wealth, whatever our backgrounds, well, God reaches out with forgiveness to you and to me. Faith is about believing that through the gift of Jesus, we can be at peace with God. When fear is removed, we end up with joy, and we too will want to seek the Lord Jesus Christ more. Well, I hope this message has struck home with you. Maybe you'll join us on our services online, if that's the best way for you to join us, or in person if you can make it when those are allowed. Well, join us. Find out more about this Jesus. He's the one who is the Saviour of humanity. It's a very exciting reality. He came with this sign of humility, and he brings the song of heaven which can be yours and mine too. Amen.
The eighth lesson is from the book of Matthew, chapter 2. The Magi are led by the star to Jesus. After Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea, during the time of King Herod, Magi from the east came to Jerusalem and asked, "Where is the one who has been born King of the Jews? We saw his star in the east and have come to worship him." When King Herod heard this, he was disturbed, and all Jerusalem with him. When he had called together all the people's chief priests and teachers of the law, he asked them where the Christ was to be born. "In Bethlehem in Judea," they replied, "for this is what the prophet has written. But you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least amongst the rulers of Judah. For out of you will come a ruler, who will be the shepherd of my people Israel." Then Herod called the Magi secretly and found out from them the exact time the star had appeared. He sent them to Bethlehem and said, "Go and make a careful search for the child. As soon as you find him, report to me so that I too may go and worship him." After they had heard the king, they went on their way, and the star they had seen in the east went ahead of them, until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they were overjoyed. On coming to the house, they saw the child with his mother Mary, and they bowed down and worshipped him. Then they opened their treasures and presented him with gifts of gold and of incense and of myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to go back to Herod, they returned to their country by another route. Thanks be to God.
The ninth lesson is from John, chapter 1. John unfolds the great mystery of the Incarnation. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, but the darkness has not understood it. There came a man who was sent from God. His name was John. He came as a witness to testify concerning that light, so that through him all men might believe. He himself was not the light. He came only as a witness to the light. The true light that gives light to every man was coming into the world. He was in the world, and though the world was made by him, the world did not recognize him. He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Yet to all who received him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. Children born not of natural descent, nor of a human decision, or a husband's will, but born of God. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling amongst us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only, who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. Thanks be to God.